All right. So, welcome everyone for this game analysis by St. Louis Chess Club on this not too cold Saturday, right? It was possible to walk out in the street without a heavy coat. That's already something exciting. And I think it is a cool idea. We spoke before I came to St. Louis that there's the club championship that was held last week and several others event, and going over games is definitely something that I think should come first to basically anything else in any player's preparation, studying. And you know, if you play something, you played it wrong, well, you play it again, then it's just your fault. First time you don't know, second time, well, your fault for not studying. So we have a game played in the club championship last week between Feingold Spencer, yes, related, right? With Mr. Askin sitting here. Oh, wait. C4, C6, G3, D5, Knight F3, Knight F6. Okay. All right, so basically it's a matter of, I guess it's a matter of style and approach. I believe that most players might already at this moment move the bishop out, play bishop g4, and if not, then especially in this position, moves like bishop g4 or bishop f5 are, I think most players that play the Slav would have this approach. e6, of course, it's a very normal approach, playing very slowly, I guess, right? b6, bishop b7 at one point will be the idea to solve the problem, always the problem of this bishop in all the Slav openings, the Queen's Gambit opening. I actually played this with White Spencer like endless amount of years ago, like when I was a young kid, because you don't need to study theory, you play b3, right? You also play b3, so kinda wanna get how would they say, double fianchetto, d3 at some point. Not really too much theory and immediate fight in the center. Most logically, White will not play d4 here, right? Not that it is a wrong move, but it will just transpose to many positions that most white players will prefer not to avoid. Although, you might play in this line, you might get to play some lines, some favorable lines, or some at least possible lines in the Catalan, right? Because basically this is like we are having this position. And okay, c6 might not be main move in this position. I mean, possible, but well, they will take on c4, but okay, of course c6 is also a possibility, just not main one. Oops, I overwrote this one. Okay, so we were at b3, knight bd7. I think knight bd7 is of course possible move. One other move usually in this position, well, what do you think, Spencer? I think that many times this is a approach by black. Because I just want to play a5, a4, exchange the pawns, exchange the rooks, you know, just help develop this part. And black, this is many times where black will be aiming in this position. And we can maybe quickly just see for a second if we have any games in this line or if any of those ideas have been played. All right, apparently a5 is being played, and well, we have decent enough players, Piquet, Timofeev, Yakovenko. Let's see the line after castle. Okay, Bariev and so on. It's among many others, it's just another very reasonable idea. I think very typical for those positions, because if you cannot prevent black from, well, narrowing the board, exchanging the A pawns, well, where will really your advantage be? Okay, but knight bd7, we cannot complain about this move. Okay. Yeah, it's always interesting. e5 is always an interesting move. I mean, we played here quite quickly. Yeah, actually many times we get those positions with bishop e7 from Queen's Gambit. Here it is interesting that black can play bishop d6. I think it's probably not bad for him.
Can you go back and tell me what I missed?
Amazing. I knew that I
came pretty well.
Exactly. I knew that I dressed well. I say I couldn't be here with, just a nice sweater or jacket and having you dressed here.
Indeed.
Perfect. What did you miss here? Well, just the A5, but now I have to be nice because the big brother of Spencer Feingold, Grandmaster Feingold is here, so I better be more polite. Alrighty. Castle. Question, well, why not E5? Just a thought. Well, how would you play here? Right. This is, I think, very important idea. Because if we believe that black is playing, putting those pawns against this bishop, then if we move them too quickly, there's nothing that makes more sense than to immediately take. Okay, I will take back.
I mean, E4 is interesting.
E4. I can think of playing d4 here, right? I think maybe I should. I think so. I mean, I'm somewhat scared if I will allow you to capture. Where exactly will my pieces be? That's black's. Yeah, I agree. I mean, I think this is at least white gets what he really wants. This why. Yeah, it's very, very tricky to move the pawns forward exactly because of this d5 square. Yeah, once again, those ideas with a5, a4 are just very, very normal. I mean, play a5, a4. Bishop here is also okay. Queen c2. So move 12. You're going to capture with the pawn, right?
Yeah, I capture the pawn. Right?
Okay.
And now, basically, a file that he's already put his rook on, now he's controlling that file. It's going to take me several moves to be able to contest it. And now my queen and my rook are stuck behind that pawn, which maybe I can admit at some point, maybe I can't. So that's why that looked weaker to me than playing c5. Because if I play c5 and he captures, I'm going to be able to keep the c-file half closed. The e-file will be open. And he has a pawn on e2 that he's either got to defend or advance or something. So that was my thought process of why I played c5 instead of e5, but I gathered that was a mistake. Not a big mistake, but
well, let's see. I mean, big mistake, or why was it a mistake? First of all, you said that white gets play on the c-file, and, well, I think that when looking at such position or any position, first of all, it's very concrete. I think black has at least a threat or an idea of a threat, let's say e4 and followed by e3. So that's something quite immediate that black wants to play. So then we have to consider which moves for white. I mean, yeah, white has the file, but black has the two central pawns. I mean, okay, if his rook was on c8, maybe it would be a tiny better here. So question is, how does white want to play against e4 by black, first one? Okay, that's a logical move.
And then again, so what he mentioned before, now I'm worried about him coming to c4 and stuck defending that e5 pawn for a while. if I play g4.
This is a little better than the previous variation since you traded the darks for bishops.
Exactly. I mean,
either
play d4, but I'm not even. I don't think I like d4 because rook c7, maybe rook c1. But maybe what if take? I mean, black has idea of playing knight c5 quickly, and followed by b6. I mean, when looking at such positions, you know, I was speaking. Alex said something actually very interesting when we spoke. I would say 4 or 5 days ago, we were discussing Houdini and Carlsen, and I don't know. Someone was asking me if I think Carlsen can beat Houdini in a game, and I said I think yes. I mean, if they play enough games, especially because, well, my thought is because Carlsen plays positions that it's really impossible to detect when the tiny evaluation changes. Like, for if people follow, you know, just his game against Anand from London, it looks like he got nothing in the opening with white. The world champion put his knight on d3, which looks really great, but probably it's actually not. And okay, you know, suddenly at some point, okay, big advantage for Carlsen, and it's really looked like nothing. So, but Alex said that, and I agree with that when looking more and more at computers, all our concepts, like what we were just saying, open files and bad bits, they are basically, at the end of the day, they are being translated into concrete moves and plans. For example, this, look what I was just saying. I say, black gonna play knight c5, attacking e4, less important attacking e4, threatening knight to d3, and then I get b6 with bishop a6, immediate move attacking the rook on f1. Okay, if this is working, then forget about all the stories. Black is more than perfect. It just has a series of forcing moves that fix his position. For example, let's look if it's working. I don't know. Let's say pawn take. And now we're going to play, well, let's play indeed our knight c5. We will look after it, what happens if knight take.
Right?
Yeah, but queen b1, I can. Oh, I can just. Queen b1. For example, I'll be happy with bishop g4. Okay, you know, maybe I will trade the bishop in some situations, rook d8. I mean, one should be careful not to get worse here in some lines. Yes?
Can't white play knight takes e5?
Knight takes e5. Okay. I was looking for some ideas like this. We have to be very concrete. Queen take?
Yeah, and queen take.
Okay, rook take?
And
f4. Right. Okay. What shall I play here? Rook h5 is obviously the first move that we are going to look at. But before rook h5, I just want to see if I have an easy escape out. Like, rook take e4, you take on c5, rook e2. Maybe I'm going to be a bit worse there. Okay, well, let's play here. What to do? Well, this is incredibly interesting. e5, right? You need to go e5. But if e5, I will play this move. Okay. Knight d3. Rook c3, and I take. I don't want to be. Before I want to be a big hero and see how I can save my piece, let me see how I'm being a little chicken and just getting into this position. And okay, I don't think I have much to worry. White has, of course, compensation, but black has to be okay, plus more than okay. So after you see those lines, then you can start thinking if.
Bishop f3,
I have bishop g4, I think. You don't want me to allow to exchange those. I mean, if bishop f3 now, I just think bishop g4 immediately. This, I think, is already not impossible to play for you. Because what in this line, of course, that I can see that I can save the piece. Like by playing such a beautiful move. But this position, I'm less in the mood. I don't know. Knight c4, knight d6. I mean, yeah, it's just one pawn, but no, this looks. Maybe it's okay for black. Maybe black can even be better. But if my opponent sacrificed like this against me, before I will start analyzing this, I just want to know that I have some bailout line, you know, that I can play some knight d3, knight ak5, and I will be okay. That's at least my idea. What do you think, Ben? It looks reasonable, right? I mean, let's just see what computers say here. Just to get a feeling. I mean, is he going to just save the pawn or? Yeah, you see? Not big difference. No, thank you. Oh, even Houdini knows how to play chess. Right? No, because you know, look, knight d3, rook c3, knight ak5, take. Okay, I'm okay there. You will maybe put some pressure, get the b pawn, I won't be worse. But I will be scared. Of course, in a real game, I will be sitting there for 15 minutes looking at knight fd7, or maybe less, because really, really a lot of pressure for white. This is, by the way, very correct approach. First, let me see minimum what I have. After it, I'll get more. This is, and rook e4, by the way, was the other move that we suggested. Rook e4, rook c5, rook takes e2. But white is a bit better there after rook f2. Yeah. Okay, that's. So, to your question, it was very interesting. Like, 95 we have to analyze. But looking at this series of moves, rook h5, e5, knight d3, knight ak5, we're going to be okay then. Yeah, and knight c5, we are totally okay, right? And here comes our idea of b6. Okay, he changed it before he was more into b6. Black is okay here. All right, we'll tell him bye bye. Just that we were looking at right lines. Okay, so e5, yes, looks dangerous, looks like opening the line, but we have to analyze a lot. Oh, wait. You played c5, but again, I think in general, black should play a5, a4, exchange that. Just makes his life much easier without the pawns on the queen side. e3. Yeah, e3 is a big question, right, Spencer? I mean, you were afraid of what, d4, e5?
Yeah, well, I wanted to answer d4 with e4 and not allow off this pawn at some moment. I want to play c takes e5 and try to maybe put some pressure on d5 and c5. And so if he plays d4 at some moment, I want to play e4, but I don't want to take off this pawn. So I thought I'd put my pawn on e3 first.
Okay, but e3 has advantages and maybe disadvantages.
Well, it's a tempo.
Not only that, it's weakening the d3 square.
Oh, yeah.
So, for example, let's allow you to think a bit. Which ideas are out there for white? I mean, to me, I think there is one clear idea that I would first look, but my question is to you. Yeah, I think either d4 right now. For me, I'm very much looking at take on d5 and then d4. Because what will I get? I will either get a reasonably okay Catalan. I mean, again, this bishop on c8, I want to fight against it. Or I will play against isolated pawn. For example, let's say take. If the pawn take, I think I'll play d4, b6. If not, you're just okay. This position, I think white should be somewhat better. Maybe not, but at least it is somewhat, I feel, well, I want to play this, or at least look at something like this with white. Maybe it's not much, but at least it's something to consider, I think. Maybe black has to take. Maybe this is not so bad for black. I thought it's going to be worse, but...
This is the line that I thought I'd, if you played C4,
yeah. I mean, the knight on d2 is not that pretty. If the knight was on c3, of course, we would take white without any doubts. Yeah, I've seen some games, like, maybe I can play really slowly, like e3 and then knight b1, knight c3. There's no huge rush. Rook will be on d1. I prefer white here, but maybe it's not that clear. And if the knight take, probably I'll go the same, right? Because black is two moves from being totally okay. b6, bishop b7, that's it, right? So let's go with d4, b6 again. Maybe 94. Oh, it is better here somewhat. Yeah, I think white's better here. If take on d4, knight take, and if not, gonna give black some weakness here. Yeah, this I think is a very principle approach, this exact position.
I
mean, but first of all, it's one move. I mean, if let's say you play e3 and black play b6.
Right.
Then what? But if he gets bishop b7 and his rook out, why would you have anything? Probably you will have nothing. I think maybe c takes d5 is also not much. I mean, I in my view, this is a critical part here. Well, let's see for another second what our friend is thinking. You understand chess? Rook e1 or c take d- okay, but before... Okay, so he's basically saying, okay, we are in the right direction, whether it's, you know, c take d5, c take d5, e4 he wants to play. That's interesting. I would... Yeah, I would think tiny less about that, but maybe it's because, maybe, yeah, b6, rook fe1, okay, this is completely different nature. I mean, it's interesting, after d4, yeah, he thinks after b6 nothing, just equal. Yeah, I wasn't certain about this position. Of course, you're right, that's exactly the way you have to play b6. And but I think, okay, e3 is basically saying, in my view, all right, I just want to move the pieces and see how it goes, but yeah, I know, this entire system, g3, b3, is, I just want to move the pieces, and it's working for some players, but, yeah, but here, oh, black is, actually, I mean, you can find yourself maybe tiny bit even suffering, tiny bit. I mean, for example, here, I want to take with the bishop. What would you play here?
Knight
e4. No, wait, I'll take.
Probably
with D?
Yeah.
Wow.
And then like
okay, let's see. I go bishop b7. No, but why wouldn't you? I mean, I don't, usually when you want to go with this pawn structure, you want to have some attack or something. I don't think you have anything there. I mean, in an endgame, I'll be happy with black.
Okay, but if I play like bishop e4 and e-trade bishops, I'm suffering
in the ocean. So maybe.
Oh, okay.
But I'll play slow here. I'll play D. We choke. I'll play this first. You see now, if the pawn is on e2, I would think really nothing.
Right.
This is okay. Maybe you'll play here, but the point is this. While and that was this is why I felt that that was the most critical point. When you take on d5, you are having ideas. d4, e4. You're challenging his center. If you allow him to play the simple b6, bishop b7, which he did, add this with e3, you can actually be tiny worse, you know. Okay, knight take. By the way, why didn't you want to exchange the bishop? I mean, of course this is okay move, but...
I guess I was thinking that the bishop was okay and that he wasn't going to want to exchange those pieces because I thought the bishop would be better.
But you know, the thing is that the bishop on g2 is defended. Bishop on b7 is not. Well, it's defended by the queen, but it takes away, in some situation, the availability of your queen to join the game. So basically, white king is going nowhere, which means the bishop on g2 is forever there. So you move the knight, he will take. But you cannot easily move the knight if the queen is out there. Or I think just for that reason, I might want to exchange. And in general, when you exchange, you tiny bit play on some light squares. White will have tiny bit, potentially. It's around equal anyway. My feeling, I will take with the bishop.
I just remembered I was thinking about if bishop d5.
Mm-hmm.
I was also considering e4.
Yeah, I was thinking about that, but once again, we will have to analyze this one very, very accurately. Very, very, very accurately. I go there. So now, but now, now super critical moment. If you don't have anything concrete, then d3 is super weak. So if d4, I play maybe rook d8. That's a problem immediate for you. But I play rook d8, rook d4, like...
Oh, yeah.
I mean, maybe b4 is something I'm analyzing a bit, but I don't think it's working. Yeah, I don't think it's...
Maybe.
What, what?
I mean, what else?
B4 looks pretty interesting.
Yeah. Maybe I can play bishop a6 here. This was my idea. Queen c3, knight c4, only way, no?
Yeah, but
exactly. Exactly. It's probably not okay. It's probably worse there. I think, but yeah, you probably should in this position just play bishop take d5, knight take d5, a3. Play exactly the same position in the game, only that I think without the bishop is slightly in black as compared to the game. And the game also okay. Okay. Yeah. The bishop on b7 is always something that you have to watch. F6, yeah, it's okay, but
maybe you didn't need to do it now, I thought.
What?
I thought you didn't need to play F6 right now.
Yeah.
Just a bishop
A8. Yeah, basically just wait, don't do much, right? I'm also thinking about knight F6. Yeah, and if take, I'll take with the pawn. And then I'll exchange a bishop, rook d5, rook d8. I mean, yeah, this position already white has his normal idea of some one day going with b4 and maybe playing against some weakness. So it's probably not nothing, of course, as well. But f6, f5. Okay, so here we can stop here for a second. I mean, not much is happening, but black already created some weaknesses. Exactly, because I will say this, even looking at the situation, white is 300 points higher, and white has nothing. So it's not saying the position is equal, that's not the important part, right? I mean, take some complicated positions in the dragon, put some 2500 to play 2200, they'll be happy as possible. But you take some positions that are pretty dead, no weaknesses, not many spots where to go wrong. This is where the pressure is. There are different types of equal. There is equal and incredibly messy, complicated, demands a lot, or equal, well, you're going to get anything. So you're saying you're happy, I think, it's because you at least see that you might have some idea to get something. I don't think here you have a lot already, but, well, e5 is weak, e6, e5 squared, the e6 pawns. You're happy, you get something to play. You're totally correct, Spencer. Knight f6. So, wouldn't it be simple to get rid of that long ago? Knight f3. Yeah, this I don't, not certain what is this move.
I think, I mean, I'm just guessing. But I thought that if after knight g4, h3, maybe he wanted to play queen f6.
D4, knight h6.
Yeah. Like maybe you, I thought that was his original plan, but he didn't want to play knight h6. I don't know what he thought.
Well, I think it was just a lack of concrete thinking again. I'm sort of thinking in these themes. I'm thinking that h3 is a little bit of a weakening of his left side. And that maybe a lady was quick at some point. But I didn't have.
But. But I will say this, so if h3 is a little bit of a weakness, and yeah, potentially you are right. I mean, I don't agree in this position, I agree in general, right? That you will have some brilliant rook take e3, bishop take g3, and everyone gets like 12. But then what about f5? If h3 is a little bit weakening, then f5. Because I'm looking at so many lines, like here, I'm just thinking, okay, you know, let me just play bishop here. Bishop c6 and queen b7. Well, I think it's a logical idea in some. But the problem in many lines we will get, e6 is tiny weakness. Okay, I don't think white has much. But for example, okay, you wasted another move. b4. You know, white is winning those positions in one of our advanced lecture when we were speaking about. Actually, it was in the intermediate lecture on Thursday. We were speaking about how to improve knights, how to improve the pieces and how we should. And we got to speak a little bit about Anderson and, you know, some, because someone was saying, but how do I win this position? Oh, there's nothing. Also, you see those positions that exactly like this. There's nothing, and then there's tiny bit, and there's one weakness, and this is how white is playing. Take, take. Okay, white's already somewhat better here. Queen. Which move would you think more? Yeah, I was looking. But again, you want to go queen b7 in some situations.
And you have defend e6, and like you have to play like queen a2 and stuff. But I thought this was the logical move.
Should he go knight e5 here, you think?
Knight e5.
I think so. Well, let's see. I mean, I want to play c6 and then put something over there, but I think 95 is a start.
Maybe 94, like the game, probably.
94.
But he doesn't have to take on
G4. Queen where?
Queen
B-O-D. Okay, pretty much has to take, take, and b5, no?
Yeah.
Take with the queen, I guess, because e6 is hanging. Oh, but here white gets something.
Yeah, it's a bit similar to the game.
So, I mean, even rook c1 at some point is something. I mean, this is your dream. You know, when you play this structure from the very beginning, it's to play that b4 and go against the a7 one. Oh, this is something for white. I mean, okay, let's see how the game continues. First of all, take, take. Maybe black just has to play some h6 there and just to get his king, just to give his king some decent spot in some lines that it won't be weak. Maybe just wait a bit here. Was also thinking, is b5 something to consider here for black? Just at least something to consider. Yeah, I know I'm not hugely excited about it either. I mean, maybe here queen e5 and knight d4 is unpleasant. Yeah, this pawn on f5. Something like this followed by knight to d4. Okay, so this is the game. Basically our line before. Yeah, rook c1. Was maybe rook c5 a possibility? I like this h6. I just want, you know, that's it. Then my king has no problems. It's going to be reasonably safe. Yeah, rook c4 is a good move. I mean, like, if the pawn on f7, I'll play queen c7, I'll play something. I mean, white has some weaknesses here. I mean, unless there is some idea here, white is just take queen e4, king h2. Yeah, let's see for a second just if we really feel this one. Yeah, okay. This rook b5, but then take on a7. That's actually about equal here. So there's just this cheap tactic that exists. But after rook b2, you're going to have big weakness over there. I mean, yeah, let's look at this position without rook c4. Yeah, this is what we're thinking. Like, white is slightly better. Like, I'm few tenths of a point. It shouldn't be probably more than that, but it's already, you have clear targets. Queen h3. But maybe this is easier for white now. Yeah. I mean, now this may be, I feel it's a mistake, because black king is weak, and e6 and a7, and for black, once white queen starts invading over there, I think that looking at ideas of knight e3 is pretty much the only thing that is left on the table for him. Maybe f4 and knight take f4, but pretty much that's what he will have to do. But now queen c8 is a threat or idea. Queen c6, right? Oh, you were afraid of exchanging queens. Yeah, so maybe move the king. King g1. That's very cool. Yeah, because I look, I say queen c6, okay, queen d5, maybe not. That's a very cool move. There's no rush here. Queen d6, queen c4. Yeah, it's this, fixing this those pawns. That makes such a big difference. I mean, let's just get a feeling how much we're here. Still, not dramatically, but I think white has already clear, easy play here. Okay, half a pawn is something. Queen d7, h4, g6. Knight take f5, knight take b5, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, this is, if we had more pieces, it would be great, right? Because the king is weak, the center, but with no pieces, those two pass pawns are no joke. But g6, I don't like.
I'm worried about that knight f5.
But okay, but what's the difference with knight f5 and move earlier or not? Let's say you do nothing here, and he plays knight f5, you're going to play knight takes b5. What then?
Well, no, I mean, I'm not worried about it immediately. I'm playing g6 with the idea that now he's not going to be able to play knight f5 and taking that threat away.
Maybe h6. Again, I'm with my h6, king h7, just so the king... Because what will happen, I'm just looking. Without looking at the rest of the game, without seeing it. After g6... King go to where g7, f7, I don't, queen c3, knight f3, that king is going to be really weak there.
G7 is a terrible spot for the king.
Yeah, and this is, you know, it's just like feeling it right now without seeing, it just shouldn't be there, I think, in this position. You're just, g6, you weaken f6, g5, e, okay, you already created many weaknesses. H6 will create the least weaknesses. And by the way, this, maybe it's the same idea. F5 was one, creating many weaknesses. You know, mainly the square E5 and the pawn on E6 and G6. Oh, we have to be careful when pushing our pawns. Yeah, that's...
I was looking at if he had played king F7.
But then you take on B5.
Yeah.
Okay, so what Spencer is suggesting is this line. Take, take, and Yeah. Yeah, I don't like g6 so much. I mean, okay, obviously this is a critical moment. Interesting. He doesn't computer. Okay, he's really between those two moves. Somehow he's okay. Now he opened a big gap between our h6, which is okay. White, of course, is better to g6. I was very surprised and almost embarrassed at the beginning that he said like g6, h6, okay. No, but now last was almost half a point difference between g6 and h6. No, h6. This is what I want to play for. No, no, yeah, g6 was minus 0809. But we have to think that way. We have to take care of that king, because the king is a bit weak, and creating minimum weaknesses. No, okay, it's not that I will be like, you know, like opening bottles of champagne playing h6, but it would be like more like getting water and nuts for, you know, bananas for another 4 hours of, exactly, for another 4 hours of nasty defending, or 3 hours of nasty defending this position with black against some angry dude. Yeah. But yeah, g6 and other made it a bit easier. But it was interesting. White got nothing in the opening and played and didn't play that aggressive. There were some moments that, yeah, some moments I think, okay, e5 here, and in this position, white should take here black. I think I prefer black a bit. I mean, for example, this, our critical bishop take d5. I prefer black tiny bit. Okay, you know, knight e4 take, or this. No, you're just giving me this proof. This is tiny bit, right? It's tiny bit. Yeah, because d3 is weakness out there, and well, whatever it's worth. Alrighty. Any other interesting games? All right, Spencer, I think you're the only victim here.
Oh, I'd be willing to put my game up.
Oh.
Poorly played.
All right, excellent. Which one?
I played it, I'm sorry, I don't remember the numbers. I played in
1878.
And
you were which color?
I'm color, I'm like 13.
1878.
Yeah.
All righty.
Like 13-something.
Yes. Okay, we can see that. And then Spencer, you'll think about which game you, which of the not pleasant game we're gonna see, are the good ones.
And I'm not used to this, so this is my second tournament game. I decided to play kind of risky, see what he would do. So I threw a bunch of things at him, and he killed me.
And he threw them back. Okay, super solid. Queen's Gambit, right?
Yeah.
All righty. Oh no, I was just. I was just recommending Alex to play this line if he wants to play this this idea. Oh man. Okay, but they play, I think, okay, b6, I think h6 is a bit more common. h6, and okay, take is possible, but
okay.
They play here and now b6. And this line has been played by pretty much everyone. It's just like one of the most basic foundations of the Queen's Gambit decline, from Karpov, Kasparov, everyone. White, black, much earlier it was played. Nigel Short was playing this line in his match against Karpov, in many other games. Carlsen plays this. I mean, okay, these days there is this big question what to do against the Lasker variation, 94. It's a big question, very big question. But the difference is that 94, I think, should be quite okay for black, but really zero winning chances at all. B6 at least keeps some game going, but okay, we will see. B6, no complaints, take, pawn take. I think that I would like to take more with the knight right now. I mean, first of all, h6 would give me an extra move. Ben, what do you think? You will take with the knight or with the pawn? I think with the knight.
If queen take,
okay, there are two possibilities. I can take with the knight, but this is how they play. Oh, this is super duper classical line. And then they play, this is Fischer-Spassky, for example. They play bishop e6, e5. Fischer was due to queen a4, queen a3. Kasparov had a game he won against Grandmaster Luc Vinans from Belgium. Yeah, because Kasparov really doesn't play this line. That was a one of the rare, I think they played in like one of those Belfort 1988 or something like that. All right, b6, take, bishop d3, bishop a6, yeah.
That was my first
choice. Yeah, this is a bit looking bizarre move. It's probably just bad move. Well, what should black play here? Normal play. Most normal play for black. Yeah, I would just tiny bit wait with c5. I mean, c5 can be a bit scary in some lines. Like, for example, I will take. Maybe take. Can be very scary. I mean, let's look at that. Just in principle, take. I mean, black is dead on the light squares. Just dead. No, this possible to play. I mean, the pair of bishops means less than nothing. I mean, tactically black has problems, strategically black has problems. No, of course the knight cannot be captured because of taking on h7. No, this is just bad. But the way to play here, bishop b7, knight bd7, playing c5. That's how we play this position. And if white does nothing, we play c4, a6, b5. I proudly tell you that when I made my big first moves in chess, they didn't last so long, but I was 7 or 8 years old, that's what I played. This was my preparation. It's a cool line. Like, you know, Ben, I'm thinking, when I was younger, I played much more reasonable classical lines, and when we get older, right? That's what we play. We play e5, we play this, then we start playing all the other junk. Bishop e6?
Yeah. Oh, did he play bishop a6?
Yeah, he played bishop a6.
Yeah,
queen a4 is a decent move. I was thinking, actually, that this move even bothers me more. Like, seriously. I have no idea. I mean, if the pawn is on c6, if you make a tiny switch, you take this back, you play here. This is, for example, one of those classical games. Portish against Kasparov. They played in 1989. Amazing game. He exchanged. The knight went to c7, e6, g6. All the usual ideas. And Kasparov won with black. It was 1989. Scalfata. It was part of the GMA. Part of the GMA tour or the World Cup that was done in those years. The previous tournament that I mentioned, Belfort, was one of them with Vinans. So that was Portish against Kasparov. But here is the difference. You are left with this dark color bishop. And instead of having all your pawns on light squares, so you have no weaknesses on the light squares, and your bishop is on dark squares, it's opposite. Your light squares are collapsing here. I mean, OK, the threat here is very simple. I want to play knight c6, take and take. So if you play h6, I just win a pawn. If you play queen e8, I'll probably somehow also win a pawn. Not immediately clear, but I don't know, maybe knight b8 is the only move. Well, it looks ugly. I mean, let's just be lazy and think. I think knight b8 to me seemed like only move, or best move at least, right? Is there anything better here? Not really. Queen a4, castle knight e5, all of them are in the same world. Actually, I thought white can be a bit more than half a point, but yeah, knight e5 or queen a4 in the same world. Oh, wait. Knight b8, knight e5. Okay, perfect. Your opponent played very well. But here I have a little problem. Well, more black than me. What happened if we go to our lecture about captures. And we will ask ourselves, what happens if white is just going to capture, capture, and capture? That's going to end up being a pawn down.
That's what happened.
But what is rook d8?
I started getting bored.
Bored? Bored. When I bored, but okay, but why to blunder a piece?
I thought it was nice, and I thought I would shoot it.
That's what it was?
I didn't
have it. Yeah. No, I mean, you know, we spoke about material, and a little bit more about material. This just finished the game. Actually, here I was thinking what I will play with white. I want to see if there are some ideas. I think white has a not just a cool move, but actually a really strong move here. I don't know, maybe I'm wrong, but... Yeah, that's an excellent move. I mean, of course I can move the knight. Okay, you play c5, I'll play rook d1, oops, I'll play anywhere, doesn't matter. Rook d1, okay, and it's not okay endgame. I mean, white king will, if take on d4, queen take, take, knight c5, king e2, it's very bad endgame because the king is weak, and but forget about endgames, like this is really tough because this is an excellent move. Take, check. No. This pawn is going exactly nowhere. This is finished. King e2, rook c1. This is finished. This should be plus a lot. And probably closer to plus 2, I think. Something like that. Just plus 1. I mean, I thought it would be more. No, maybe I'm too optimistic for white position. Of course, it's on the verge of winning, but I thought it would be more. Okay, it's still like queen c6 as the best move, so that's cool. But why is he... That's interesting. All right, I disagree. But maybe he sees some line. The knight is not easy to get out. All right. Computer thinks not winning immediately, but still this is best line. But keeping c7 there is idea. I think it's very bad, but maybe for computer there are some lines there. But okay, nothing, what to see here in this position. He'll play knight c6. Yeah. And he got the same position, only that he's not a pawn up, but he's a knight up and won the game. Okay, so don't get bored. I mean... It was actually, okay, bishop a6 was a bit inaccurate, but really the game was over when you blundered the pawn on d5 and then went tiny bit too aggressive.